Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to Central Parkway Baptist Church on this beautiful Sunday in February, right? First Sunday in February. We're glad you're here today. The Lord Jesus Christ is the most important person in our worship service. And after the Lord, we hope that our guests feel that warmth and that welcome, the love of our Central Parkway Baptist Church family. So if you're visiting for the first time or the first time in a long time, welcome, and we hope that you feel the love of our church family. If you'd like to leave us a note or some information that we could keep in prayer for you, you could find near your seats a connection card. If you fill that out, you could drop it in the offering plate when that time comes, and we'll be sure to pray for you and connect with you any way that you'd like us to. Just a few announcements to go over so that we're all on the same page. On the 18th of February, we're going to be holding Love, Laughter, and Lunch put on by our hospitality team. They are going to provide some drinks for us, and we are going to bring something that we love to eat or something that others love to eat. So it's a potluck on February 18th following this service. Everybody's invited. It's going to be a nice time of fellowship. So please make it a point to come on the 18th and bring a dish, a dessert, anything that you'd like. We'd love to share that with you. Also, in just a couple of weeks, we're going to be mailing out about 2,500 invitations to our surrounding community. And so we want to be ready for folks that might want to take us up on that invitation. We put a postcard together, and one side's in English and the second side's in Spanish, advertising both of our English and Spanish services. And so that, of course, means that we want to be ready for them in the nursery and in the preschool area. So if you'd be willing to volunteer for an hour a month, 2 hours a month, anything that you're willing to offer, we're happy to train and to put you to good service to be able to meet the needs of those families that are going to be coming, Lord willing, and visiting us. There's a men's breakfast, right, Carrie, this Saturday at Denny's as he's ducking and weaving under the camera, right? Saturday at 9 a.m.? All right, at Denny's. And all men invited to come and enjoy a time of fellowship there. Wonderful. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to gather together and to pray and to sing, to offer our praises to you. We pray, Lord, that you would capture our heart's affection and our mind's attention, that everything we do and say would be to your glory and honor. In Jesus' name, amen. And before our music team leads us in singing, I'd just like to wish my quinceañera, my daughter Lily, a happy 15th birthday today. And it's Annette's birthday. Annette's birthday today. So happy birthday, Annette. Another quinceañera with us today. Oh, very good.
Good morning. Please stand if you're able, and let's worship the Lord.
Thank you. I honor you. 'cause you are my King, Jesus, you are my King.
You may be seated. Thank you.
Did your pick go flying? Okay. Sorry, in the middle of that song, I saw something fly up. I was like, John, oh, your pick went flying. Man, good morning, church. What an awesome day to be in the Lord's. Am I on, Mitch? Am I on? Okay, cool. So, let me give the Central Parkway, let me give you a little scary news. You ready? 4 months from today, Vacation Bible School kicks off. Man, so it has been, so you know the Miles household around the kitchen table has been some great discussions. We'll call them that, so. Hey, if anybody's got big cardboard, like refrigerator-sized box cardboard, let me know. I'll come pick it up. So we got some crazy things going. So, but man, as we enter our time of worship through prayer, I'm going to introduce you to a North American missionary. They are serving in the suburb of Indiana. Anybody from Indy in here? No? Okay. So they started Mercy Hill Church to share Christ with their neighbors. But how do we share Christ with our neighbors? By partnering in local schools, by engaging families, Vacation Bible School. Christ just doesn't live inside the walls of the church. Christ lives in you. When you come into the walls, Christ is there. But when you're at home, when you're at work, when you're at the job, when you're meeting family and friends, Christ is there also. Christ is always with you. But how do we know where to go? It all starts with prayer. It all starts, bless you, whoever sneezed. It all starts with knowing where God wants us to go. Having that conversation with God. Having that quiet, intimate time with Him. So, as our tradition here, we're going to take a few moments. We're going to bow our heads. We're going to have a conversation. Even though this microphone keeps going on and off in my ear. So, continue to share with God. Share your hopes. Share your dreams. It's something I shared in Sunday school today. Those deepest, darkest, intimate secrets that you have that nobody else knows, guess what? God does. God knows those. And He loves you greater than your worst sin. But His desire is for you to have faith and to trust in Him and to share those secrets with Him. Confess those. Pray for our missionaries like Brad and Jen that are serving. Pray for peace in Jerusalem. Pray for peace in your own life. Pray for peace in this nation. So we'll take a few moments, let's bow our heads, let's have that conversation, and I'll come back and close this shortly.
Thank you.
Most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you. We thank you and praise you for this moment that you have created. Lord, that we are able to gather right now as brothers and sisters in you, Lord. Lord, you are the creator, the sustainer, and the healer, Lord. Lord, you have brought each one of us together for one reason, your reason. Lord, I ask right now, Lord. Lord, there is the outside world that is buzzing on our hips and in our minds. We are thinking about things that we have to do, Lord. Lord, I ask that you would give us clarity. Lord, that you would give us the opportunity to focus on you. Lord, that you would open up our hearts and our minds to the worship, to the word that Brother Paul will be bringing today, Lord. Lord, that it will touch us in a way that only you can, Lord. Lord, we thank you that we are never alone. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that through the challenges of this week, when Satan wants to show us or tell us that we are the only ones suffering, there are so many others suffering. But you are right there with us, Lord. Lord, thank you for never giving up on us. Lord, we pray for missionaries like Brad and Jen that are serving their communities and loving their neighbors, not because of where they're located, but because they are created by you, Lord. Lord, right now the conflict in this country and around this world, Lord, you see Satan just stoking the fires. Lord, we ask that your hand, your blanket of peace be upon this entire world. Lord, peace in Jerusalem, in Gaza. Peace in the United States of America. Lord, that you would just bring comfort. Lord, that you would bring an end to those that are trying to dominate others because of political or economical situations, Lord. Lord, we just look to you. Lord, I pray for each one that's in this room right now. Lord, I just pray that your presence would lift us, encourage us. Lord, as we continue on, we thank you and we praise you in your son's name. Amen.
Please stand if you're able, and let's worship the Lord with our last song.
Highest of heights to the depths of the sea, creation revealing your majesty, from the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring, every creature unique in the song that it sings, all exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name, you are amazing, God, all powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. Who has sold every life on gold where it should go, or seen heavenly storehouses laden with soul. Who imagined the sun and gives source to its light, yet concealed it to bring us the coolness of night. None can fathom, indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God. Indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. You are amazing, God.
Isn't it truly? Weird, I have a microphone. Isn't it truly amazing when these three voices are together? What a beautiful sound that is. That's amazing to see that. Please join me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for this opportunity to gather in your house as one family. And Lord, as we're about to give back to you a small portion of what you've so graciously given, bless the gift and the giver in your Son's name. Amen.
Invite you to turn in your copy of God's Word to the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, as we look at verses 29 through 39. Mark 1, 29 through 39. There's a Bible available for you in the chair near you, and also the words of the Scripture will be projected on the monitors on the screens that are behind me. You could follow along that way as well. The Word of the Lord from Mark chapter 1, verse 29. And immediately he left the synagogue and entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law lay ill with a fever, and immediately they told him about her, and he came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. And the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening, at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or oppressed by demons. And the whole city was gathered together at the door. And he healed many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. And rising very early in the morning, while it was still dark, he departed and went out to a desolate place, and there he prayed. And Simon and those who were with him searched for him. And they found him and said to him, "Everyone is looking for you." And he said to him, "Let us go to the next towns that I may preach there also, for that is why I came out." And he went throughout all Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and casting out demons. May the Lord bless the reading of his word to our hearts and minds and hands, that we might not only be hearers but doers of God's word. On Netflix, they have a number of these shows that are matchmaking shows. And so they usually take place amongst a particular cultural group of people, ethnic group of people, and it's kind of fun if you're into that, or even if you're not, you might not know it, but you get invested in the lives of the people that are being matched, and you either like them or not like them depending on their personality, and you hope that they find love, or you say to yourself, they're never going to find love, and that's kind of a something that Christy and I like to watch, okay, these matchmaking shows on Netflix. There's a particular one of these shows that follows, it's called Indian Matchmaking, and in this culture, traditionally, marriages are arranged, right? In other words, mom and dad get together with mom and dad and decide that they're going to make a marriage here, and oftentimes, the bride and groom meet already after the wedding has already been, the date's already been placed. Yeah, they're getting married. They're just now coming to find out about it. You know, it's a done deal. And then, of course, with Western culture and the idea of love marriages, that's kind of taken a hold. So the cultures change, and now some folks, they don't want an arranged marriage. They want a love marriage, right? They like in our culture, you want to be walking along one day and hoping that Cupid is flying around somewhere above you with his arrows ready, and he shoots, and poof, you know, there's little hearts swirling around your head, and you meet Mr. and Mrs. Wright, and they lived happily ever after, is what people hope for. Well, kind of a happy medium, the people in this show employ a matchmaker that tries to bridge that gap between traditional arranged marriage with love marriage. And so it's interesting to watch that sort of thing. Now, I'm not saying which way is better, because honestly, I don't know. I think that arranged marriages have a better track record as far as less of a divorce rate than love marriages. I know my girls, whenever mom wants to try to play matchmaker, they balk at it. They say they don't want any part of it. You know, they want to find love on their own sort of thing. That's the way our culture is. But it's easy to recognize, right? Particularly on the love marriage side, that oftentimes when we marry for love, we're marrying an idea of who this person is. It's oftentimes idealized. And we will, if we stick with it, soon learn that the person that we thought we were marrying isn't necessarily the person that we married, right? Now it takes work. Now it takes commitment. Now it takes dedication if this thing is going to work, right? Oftentimes, if it doesn't work out, it's because we married an image of somebody that really wasn't the real deal. It was just, again, a hope-so or an idealized kind of situation. Now, I say that kind of story because particularly here in the Gospel of Mark, we see at the onset, at the beginning of the ministry of Jesus, that he has these clashes, these maybe disagreements or maybe just a general sense of this is who we think that Jesus is, or this is who we think that Jesus ought to be, with the Jesus of reality. And so we see that Jesus' family has a hard time understanding Jesus in the Gospels. We see that his disciples have a hard time understanding Jesus. We see that the religious leaders have a hard time understanding Jesus. And so it's this wrestling with the idea of who is Jesus? How do we find the real Jesus and follow him versus the Jesus that we think Jesus ought to be? And so that's what we're looking at in today's passage. We're kind of searching for Jesus and maybe placing ourselves in the seats or in the lives of the people that were encountering him as he began his ministry, and trying to clash or compare and contrast our ideas or our thoughts of who Jesus ought to be with the actual person of Jesus. And so first, we're going to look at Jesus at home. Jesus at home. We see in verse 29 where we began that it says, and immediately, right? And that's kind of the pace of the first 8 chapters of the book of Mark. And immediately, it's action. One thing after another. Jesus moves from the synagogue, and now he's at home. And we see, as we read the whole scripture, that soon he's going to be immediately going to other towns, other synagogues, to preach and teach. The pace is fast, and it's furious. Jesus is a man of action as he begins his ministry, and it's fast-pitched. And so we see here in verse 29 that immediately he leaves the synagogue and enters the home of Simon, who we know as Peter, and Andrew, his brother, and they're with the other two disciples at the time, James and John. And then, verse 30 says, now Simon's mother-in-law lay ill with a fever, and immediately they told Jesus about it. So not only does he immediately leave the synagogue and enters Peter's home, or Simon's Peter's home, but immediately upon entering the home, he's told that Peter's mother-in-law is laying ill with a fever. Now, why is this? I suppose, because I've been there, and I think probably you have too, where you invite someone over, but you need to make some kind of concession or some kind of apology because things aren't as ideal as maybe you were hoping they could be, right? What do I mean by that? Well, it's not unusual for you to invite somebody into your home, or somebody shows up and you invite them in and you say, excuse the mess, right? Excuse the disorder. I didn't have time to pick up, or I didn't have time to clean up, right? And so oftentimes when somebody comes over, we might make an excuse for the way things are because they're not what we would hope that they would be. And I think that's what's going on here. It's after synagogue, it's after church, so to speak, and they're home and maybe hungry, and maybe per usual, right? When someone enters a home in a first century Jewish kind of context, they'd be greeted with a kiss at the door, right? They have their feet washed and readied, and then they'd be invited to recline at the table, and they'd be served a meal. That would be customary. And so maybe Peter is mentioning that his mother-in-law is sick because he's excusing that the normal expected hospitality is going to fall a little short today, right? The normal spread that we might usually enjoy when we have a guest and a guest rabbi over after a synagogue meeting, it's not going to be fully extended because we're kind of short-staffed today, so to speak. And so maybe they're going to open up a can of tuna or sardines that Peter caught last week on the Sea of Galilee, or maybe they're going to have a peanut butter and hummus sandwich or something like that. It's not going to be the big deal that it could be or that it usually is. But what does Jesus do? He goes and he grabs Peter's mother-in-law by her hands and he lifts her up. And what does it say? After he lifts her up, what does she do? Yeah, she serves them, right? Immediately. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up, and the fever left her, and she began to serve them. Now, some people, when they read that, if they're honest, they'll say, well, that's kind of rough, right? She's just getting over being sick, and now they make her go to the the kitchen and prepare a meal for everybody. Or that's, you know, kind of sexist, or why does the mother-in-law have to be the one to prepare the meal? You know, what's wrong with the guys? Why can't they do it? But I think if we look at it that way, we're missing the point. The word used for wait on or serve is the Greek word diakonine. And it's the same word that's used of the angels who attend to Jesus in chapter 1, verse 13, at his temptation. And it's the same word that Jesus used that's translated to serve in chapter 10, verse 45, when Jesus declares that the Son of Man comes not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. So we're learning quite early that the purpose of the ministry of Jesus Christ is one of service. Serving is a way that characterized the ministry of Jesus, and the kingdom of God is exemplified through service. It's the word that we use for deacon, is to serve. So the proper response to one who has been touched by Jesus is to serve. To serve the Christian fellowship. And so I think Peter's mother-in-law is understanding quite early something that the apostles are going to be a little slower to kind of grasp. That Jesus is coming to serve. Jesus is calling us to do likewise. Do we want to find Jesus at home? Look to wherever the service is happening. Husbands, do you want Jesus in your home? And serve your wives. Wives, do you want Jesus in your home? Serve your husbands. Parents, do you want to see Jesus in the life of your children? Serve them. Children, do you want to see Jesus in your home? Serve one another. Serve your siblings. Serve your parents. That's where Jesus is at home, in service. That's subtle, but I think it's there very clearly. But then there's a transition, right? Look at verse 32. It says, that evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or oppressed by demons. And the whole city was gathered together at the door. A couple of things. The Sabbath is now ended in the evening time, right? It's from sun up to sunset. And so the Sabbath has come to a close, so now it's possible for work to go on as normal. And so I think that's why this big influx of people to Peter's home happened at sundown. Now my question is in verse 32, who are the they? That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or oppressed by demons. Who was it they? Who brought them to Jesus? Yeah, the disciples, right? Particularly, we could imagine, it was Peter, right? This was his neighborhood. This was his town. And so he says, well, hey, this person down the street, they have the same fever that my mother-in-law has. It's been going around, right? Or this person, he's really down and out, and he's been acting funny. He might have an unclean spirit like that other man in the synagogue. And so Peter knows these people in town, and so he sees what happens to his mother-in-law. He's amazed. And so while Jesus is maybe ministering or talking to the mother-in-law about things, he looks at the fellow disciples that are with him, you know, his brother, and then James and John. He says, hey, let's go, right? Jesus called us to follow him and to be fishers of men. Whatever that means, let's go fish for people. Let's go bring some people to Jesus. I think we have to notice here, right? And we talked about this a little bit last week. I think it's worth noting when it says they brought them to Jesus, throughout the gospel, there's no indication that Jesus himself initiated or went out looking for patients or went out looking for demons to slay, right? In the Gospel of Mark, throughout the whole Gospel, they're either being brought to him or taking the initiative in approaching him themselves. And I bring this up because reading it kind of made me ask the question. I never really thought of it before. But why did they bring these folks to Jesus? In other words, maybe we have to put on our sanctified imagination here, and we could have a difference of opinion. But I always just figure that maybe Jesus told them to do that. But as you read the Gospel of Mark, and as we look here in a minute at what happened again with the unclean spirit that came, with the person that was oppressed, I don't think it was. I don't think Jesus said, okay, it's sundown, it's safe from the religious authorities, we could get to work now, go bring in as many people as you can because revival's about to break out here. We're going to make your house, Peter, into the first tabernacle of Capernaum, right? First Baptist Church, Capernaum. It's on. Let's go. Go get them. I don't think that's what's happening. I think, like I said, Peter, and knowing what we know about Peter's character, Peter took it upon himself to say, hey, let's do something with this, right? Let's not just sit here idle. It's time to get to work. It's sundown. Sabbath is over. Let's get this show going. And he went out and he brought in as many people as he can. And again, in verse 32, it says that the door was jammed, packed. The whole city was gathered together at the door. And the interesting thing is, and he would not permit the demons, right? When he cast out, in verse 34, he healed many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. So Peter brought them. Jesus, as we know, had compassion on them, and he healed them. He ministered to them. And he even, again, cast out many demons. But he wouldn't permit the demons to speak. And we know from other miracles that even non-demonic kind of miracles, healing miracles, when people wanted to shout it from the rooftops, he would say no. It's the secret in Mark, the messianic secret. Why? If they're establishing First Baptist Church Capernaum, if they want revival, right? 7 nights. Bring your family, friends, bring everybody. If that's what they're getting at, why keep it silent? Why not advertise? And we talked about it again a little bit last week, but there's an option, and it's probable that there's some of this, that if people are thinking about Jesus as a military deliverer and one who's going to bring down the Roman Empire, and if that gets out to Rome, if Rome hears about it, then Jesus' ministry is going to be cut short, right? And he's not going to be able to do what he was called to do. So some people say that they didn't want it publicized because it wasn't politically or strategically beneficial. It wasn't the best thing to do. Now, that's probably maybe part of it, but I don't think that's at the heart of it. And again, I think what's happening is Jesus knew that they didn't yet grasp the full picture. They didn't understand what it was, who he was, or why he came. They yet didn't or weren't able to grasp the reality of what kind of Messiah this is. Jesus identified with the suffering servant of Isaiah more than anything else, I think, more than any other picture of the Messiah. Jesus, was most closely identified with the suffering servant. And the suffering servant in Isaiah is one that practices restraint. He's one that's humble. He's one who serves. And Jesus is heading towards a cross. And unless you have the picture of the cross and the picture of the suffering servant, you don't have the whole picture of who Jesus is. And it's so easy to spread misinformation. Today more than ever, but even back then, as news travels fast. And I think it's for that reason that Jesus was silencing those that were wanting to shout it from the rooftops. So in Mark, we see that the crowds misunderstand Jesus. The disciples misunderstand Jesus as well, because look what happens in this next transition. We see that Jesus rises very early in the morning while it's still dark, and he departs, and he goes out to a desolate place where he prayed. So Jesus, after a long day of serving and ministering, and then after sundown, right, more people came, and so he came, they came, and he had compassion, and he healed them, and he ministered to them. So I don't know how long that lasted, but eventually he probably got some sleep, but waking up early in the morning, he went out into a desolate place, the same word that's used for his temptation, out in the wilderness, right? He went out to a desolate place to pray. And look what happened. I imagine someone knocked at Peter's door, maybe with a limp or maybe with a fever, and there was a trail of people behind him, and they were ready for day two of the revival. And so Peter turns to look, and Jesus isn't there. Where's Jesus? We already have a line of folks that are here for the second night of this revival meeting. This is getting good. This is gaining some traction. Our movement is going to grow. But where's Jesus? And so the word there that it says they went searched for him, verse 36, the word is it's a word that could be translated hunted. It's an aggressive word. So Peter went out, and you can imagine Peter, he went out hunting. He took the other disciples with him, and they went out hunting for Jesus. This seems innocent enough. But Peter doesn't stop to ask the question, why isn't Jesus here? Or why is he in the wilderness? Why is he away? Instead, the assumption says, Jesus, there's people that are seeking you out already. There's people that are waiting for you. Peter has another, a little more infamous opposition to the ministry of Jesus in chapter 8, verse 32 through 33, right? When Jesus has to almost exorcise a demon from Peter and saying, hey, get behind me, Satan, because you have your heart set on things of man, not of God. And so this is another kind of intrusion into the ministry and the plan that Jesus has, that God has for Jesus, and that Jesus wants to perform and do. And Peter is here, again, a stumbling block, maybe for the first time, in the ministry of Jesus. And then the words that he says, they're looking for you, right? He says, everyone is looking for you. We could look at that as a good thing. Hey, everybody's looking for Jesus. That's wonderful. Were that be the case that everyone is looking for Jesus. Except when you look in the book of Mark, what happens is when that is phrase is used, when they're searching for Jesus, in the latter half of the book, it's because they want to plot to kill him. In the middle of the book, it's because they're in disbelief and they don't have faith. And then here at the beginning of the book, it's again, they're trying to get in the way of what God has in store for Jesus to do. His family comes in chapter 3 to kind of take him away from his ministry. And here, Peter is trying to get him away from what God wants him to do. And so seeking, in the book of Mark, is an attempt to determine or control rather than to submit and to follow Jesus. So in this respect, seeking for Jesus is not a virtue in the Gospel of Mark. Discipleship consists not in attempting to control God's work, but in following God's Son. Again, the invitation to Peter and to John and to James and to Andrew in verse 17 of chapter 1 was to follow me. Follow me, and I will make you become fishers of men. Follow me. The idea here being that Jesus is in the deserted place. Jesus is in the place that's away from everybody, and he's praying. And that Peter and the fellows, they're hunting him out. They're angry. They want to get this thing going. And they stop and they see Jesus. And instead of telling Jesus what Jesus ought to be doing, maybe by God's grace there's a pause or there's an awakening. And they say, oh, he's praying. Maybe we ought to follow him. Maybe we ought to pray. Maybe we ought to let him set the agenda. So often, and I think it's the case today, and that's why I say I want us to wrestle with this, if at all possible. I want to put us in the position of being unconverted, de-evangelized, and to say, what does it mean to follow Jesus? So often, we treat the person like a prescription. Those commercials for prescriptions where, I don't know, it might be a some skin disease commercial or some other terrible disease they have commercials for, and everyone, they're playing tennis in the sun or they're having a picnic or playing volleyball, and everybody's happy, and they have this disease, but they're happy because the medicine is working, right? But then at the end of the commercial, what do you get? You get this guy talking in the background of the music and really fast saying, may cause dismemberment or death. Take with caution, talk to your doctor, whatever, whatever, whatever. But there's people smiling and dancing in the commercial, right? We do that. I think we've done that with Jesus, right? Are you tired? Sad? Lonely? You need Jesus. Is your money running low? You need Jesus, you know? Jesus is the answer to every single personal problem that we might have. You need Jesus. And then the voice fast underneath the music, the background music and the band and the lights and the charismatic preacher is saying, if anyone were to come after me, let him take up his cross daily and follow me. Whoever wishes to gain his life must lose it. Whoever gains his life, whoever loses his life for my sake will keep it. Jesus says, follow me. Jesus sets the agenda. Jesus offers us a way to live in this life, a way to face this life, a way to live in this life, a way of discipleship. He sets the agenda. The question is, do we follow him? Do we follow Jesus? I think there's levels of development, right, and levels of growth. And I think, you know, sometimes, again, it's romanticized and we become a Christian or we follow Christ for some kind of romanticized opinion or option or belief that my life will change and get back on a positive track if only I kind of make this decision and take this pill of Jesus in my life. I think that's valid, and I think that's well-meaning and well-intentioned, and I think that's how a lot of us maybe got started on this journey. But it won't last. When the trials come, when the temptations come, when life sets in, when reality sets in, and we question, why did I ever get involved in this to begin with? What's the point? What's the benefit? I'd rather jump to that other guru or to that other self-help or to that other pill or to that other drug because that's going to make me happier. That's what's going to get my life in the direction that I want it to go. But it was never Jesus that offered you all that fluff. It was never Jesus that made you all those guarantees, all those false assumptions, and all those false hopes. That was never Jesus. Jesus' invitation was, come follow me, and I will make you become fishers of men. Come follow me into a life of serving your fellow man. Come follow me and learn how to lose your life for my sake. Come follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Let's pray together. Gracious and Heavenly Father, we thank you for Jesus. The way, the truth, and the life. The only way to the Father. And Father, we thank you for his graciousness, his patience, and his love, and his consistent call. And so even today, as we prepare to come to this table together, the Lord's Supper, we're reminded again, not only of the cost of our salvation, but the cost of our discipleship. Father, help us to no longer misunderstand Jesus or seek a Jesus that really isn't there. We pray these things in his name. Amen. Amen. Church, we are going to enter into a time of celebrating the Lord's table. And so the deacons that are here to help serve, I'm going to call on you to come forward. And it's an appropriate response to the message of the gospel, particularly the gospel in Mark that we read today. What do you think? The Apostle Paul states in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, I received from the Lord that which I also delivered unto you. On the night in which he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread, and after having given thanks, said, take, eat, this is my body, which is for you. In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this every time you drink of it in memory of me. We thank God for the body and the blood of Christ and the opportunity to share it together. Like Peter's mother-in-law, who, being touched by Christ, went on to serve her community, serve her church, and we're invited to do the same as we take in Christ or to live out Christ, right? And here in our own community and wherever we're sent, and oftentimes that means sacrifice, right? That's the picture of what our Lord did. Brother Kerry, will you pray giving thanks to God for this bread and this cup?
Father God, God of all creation, sovereign God, we thank you, Father, for sending your Son to die for us on the cross and taking the punishment that we deserve, Father, and raising him on the third day. We thank you, Father, for that. We thank you, Father, for bringing us here together to take our Lord's Supper, Father. We love you. We give you all the glory and the praise, Father, if only you deserve it. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
we've already begun. If you haven't yet, you could remove that top layer of the cellophane, revealing the wafer, symbolizing the body of Christ. Jesus said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is for you. Eat of it, all of you." In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this every time you drink of it in memory of me." As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Church, that's our proclamation. That's our testimony to the world. The body and the blood of Christ shed for many for the forgiveness of sins. If you're visiting with us today, again, thank you for being here among us. It is a tradition in our church on the first Sunday of the month to take the Lord's Supper, but we also participate in a benevolence offering that helps church members in times of financial crisis. If you're willing and able to participate in that, there's an opportunity as you exit. There's also a waste bin in the hallway where you could deposit your cup, if you would do that for us. And don't rush off without greeting one another, particularly if you see somebody you don't recognize. Let them know how happy you are that they were here with us today. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you, cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you, lift up his countenance upon you, and give you peace. Church, we'll see you, Lord willing, very soon. Oh, thank you, Carrie.